they say an elastic string of natural length L and modulus of elasticity mg has one end fixed to a point A, okay, has one end fixed to a point A and the onto a point A on a smooth horizontal table. The other end is attached to a particle P of mass m. The particle is held at a point on the table with AP equal 302 L and is released. Find the speed of the particle when the string reaches its natural length. So the first thing you do when you read a question like this is, Uday, you first draw your diagram. And the most important thing is to draw the diagram and to mark all the forces. So let's draw the diagram and mark all the forces. So exercise 2D, question number 1. So an elastic string of natural length L. So you draw an elastic string of natural length N, modulus of elasticity mg has one end fixed to a point A on a smooth horizontal table. So draw a horizontal table. So you mark the point A and you have your elastic string. Natural length of it is L. Natural length of it is L. And then what are we doing? And then what are we doing? The other end, so the lambda, okay, that's right, lambda is mg. The lambda value is mg, modulus of elasticity is mg, okay. The other end is attached to a particle P, okay. So at the other end, you are attaching a particle P. At the other end, you attach a particle P, okay. So that is also fine. Now what? Now they are saying the particle is held at a point on the table with AP 3/2L. So are you just going to leave this object at the string at its natural length? What do you mean by 3/2L? What have they done? If AP is 3/2L, so obviously, what have they done in this system? What have they done here? Can someone quickly tell me what have they done? AP is 3/2L means they have, the particle is stretched, right?
They have stretched it. Yeah.
Stretched it. How much? Can you tell me how much is it stretched? 0.5. So by 0.5, right? So this is the so by 0.5. Let's mark natural length is L. And the extension is, so 3/2L, 1.5L, which means your extension is half L. So you have extension of half L, right? So what are we doing? So this is the particle with, they have not given you any weight or anything, right? No, just the lambda value, okay. Of mass M, the mass is given. So the mass is M. The particle is held at a point table, okay, and it's released. So you are stretching it and you are releasing. Tell me what is obviously going to happen here. So you have a particle attached to your elastic string and you have stretched it. So you have stretched it beyond its natural length, half L beyond its natural length, and then you are going to release it. Obviously, the moment you release it, what's going to happen with that? Obviously, the moment you release, is it going to stay here or is it going to move? And if it's moving,
it's going to return to its original length.
It will try to go into its original length, and while traveling to its original length, is it going to go at a constant speed or will it accelerate? What do you feel? Think of it. When you are releasing this, you have stretched and you're releasing it. Now this object, the elastic string, always it wants to go to its natural length. So when it wants to go to its natural length, until it reaches its natural length, obviously it will accelerate. Okay, but it won't be a constant acceleration. It will not be a constant acceleration. So we will be talking about that concept in simple harmonic motion, where we talk in detail about the acceleration also. So that way we will not go into detail about that in chapter 2. So that will be happening in chapter 3. So at this point, this will go accelerating until it comes to this point. Okay, so it's accelerating. They are asking find the speed of the particle when the string reaches its natural length. So because it's accelerating and coming over here, you know, it will definitely have a certain amount of speed. So it's going to come here. This object is going to travel this way. And it, at the point it comes here, they want the speed. They are asking you to find the velocity. They want to find the velocity. So my first question, is this a system where energy is conserved or is it a system where we lose a part of our energy? What do you think? Consider this point. So the starting point is over here, ending point is over here. is this a system where we have conserved energy, or is this a system where we lose energy? What do you think?
They say it's a smooth horizontal table, so no friction.
They say it's a smooth horizontal plane, so definitely there is no friction, which means energy is, conserved. You have a conserved energy system here. So you have a conserved energy system here, right? So that means the energy at this point, let's say this was point P, or let's say give it a name. So let's say point B and this is point C. So energy at point B and the energy at point C are definitely equal. Okay, so the whatever the energy you have at point B, the energy at the point B is definitely equal to the energy you have at the point C. So now I want you all to think about all the energies you have at B. Okay, now think about it. You are releasing the particle B. So when you are releasing this particle B, I think they say you are releasing it from rest, right? You just release it. So you are gently releasing it. You are not pushing it and releasing it. So then tell me, what are the energies? What are the energies you have at the point B? Now think about all the energies you have learned in M2. What are the energies we know? So you have learned about something called kinetic energy. You are aware of something called gravitational potential energy. And in this chapter, you learned about something called elastic potential energy, right? So those are the three types of energies we have. Those are the three energies we have. So at this point B, what type of energies do we have?
So only elastic potential energy.
Yes, okay. Aditya says elastic potential energy. Unit says elastic potential energy and gravitational potential energy. So when it comes to GPE, gravitational potential energy, in what kind of systems do we need GPE? So the GPE do we need GPE for a system where you are traveling fully horizontal?
Vertical only, right? Yeah, GPE should be above height.
Not vertical also, Aditya, not simply on a vertical. Even if it's on an inclined plane, you have GPE. GPE is MGH, right? GPE is basically MGH. So you need a height difference. You know, in any
height difference.
To find the GPE, you mark a GPE zero level. You mark a GPE zero level. And if you're above your GPE zero level, you have a positive GPE. If you are below your GPE zero level, you have a negative GPE. Do you remember that? So in this situation, when you're traveling from B to the point C, There is obviously no difference in height. There is no difference in height. So you are at the same GPE level. So therefore, you don't have to worry about GPE. GPE does not need to be considered here. Right. So then if there's no GPE, there's no need actually, because they're on the same horizontal level. GPE levels are the same. It will not matter. Then what matters at B then? What matters at B then? You can see it's stretched.
Yeah,
right?
This is before you release or after you release?
Sorry?
At B when you're asking. You're asking energy before you release or?
The moment you release. The moment you release, you know you are releasing from rest. It will accelerate, but the starting speed is zero.
Yeah.
Your starting speed is zero. Madhagariyan, your starting speed is zero, which means if your starting speed is zero, do you have kinetic energy?
No.
So then the only energy you have at E at B is your elastic potential energy. You only have your elastic potential energy at B. So then what about at C? What are the energies you have? Now you can see when you come to point C, do we have any extension? Are we having any extension in our string? Do we have X value? What is X when you come to C? How much is X?
Zero.
So if your X is zero.
Zero, right?
If your X is zero, are you going to have any elastic potential energy? To have any elastic potential energy if your X value is zero? Obviously, no.
No.
And I'm getting EPE in it. There is no EPE at point C. Then what do you have at C? You only have, obviously, you are accelerating and coming here. You have some kind of a speed. So then the only energy
Kinetic
energy. So then I would prefer if you could use some nice words here. So elastic potential energy, you can see if you start at B and you are actually, what elastic potential energy is, are you losing it or gaining it when you come to C? When you travel from
the losing it.
You are losing it. So we can say EPE loss, because you are losing, right? Well, B is when you travel from B to C, okay, the extension becomes zero and gradually. So your elastic potential energy is losing it. you're losing it. And what happens from B to C? From B, you start with a velocity of 0 and you're increasing in velocity because you're accelerating. Your velocity increases when you come to C, right? So what about KE? Are you having a gain in KE or are you having a loss in KE? You start with 0. You start with a 0 speed. And you are now gaining speed, and you're coming to a certain speed here, which is definitely getting higher, right? So then this is called
kinetic
energy gain. So this is nice if you could write like this. The EPE loss is equal to KE gain. EPE loss is equal to KE gain. So this is much better if you could write like that. And now just substitute everything and get the value. What do they want? They want you to find the speed of the particle when the string reaches its natural length, right? So let's put all the values. So elastic potential energy is lambda x square over 2L. Kinetic energy is half mv square. Kinetic energy is half mv square. Okay, let's substitute the values lambda. So elastic modulus of elasticity, lambda is mg. It says in the question, lambda is mg. Extension, x value is, how much is x? How much
it's
is it?
0.5L.
0.5L, and you're going to square it, right? X square over 2 times L is natural length is L. So half mass is M, right? That doesn't change. Half MV square. Now, your task is to make V the subject. Your task is to make V the subject. They want to find the speed. So make V the subject. You can cancel off a M to a M. And you can cancel out, these two can come up in front. So you get here, these two goes to the other side. 2g 0.5 square will give you how much? 0.25, right? Am I correct? So I think you can cut off L to L. You can cut off a 2 to a 2. Can you all multiply g with the it's like actually 1 over 4, 0.25 is 1 over 4 G. 1 over 4, 0.25 is 1 over 4. This 2 to 2 cancels. This 2 cancels. And then you get here 1 over 4 G L. Is equal to V square. So which means V equals to square root of 1 over 4 GL. So I think I can take 1 out of the square root as 1, 4 comes out of the square root as 2. Inside the root you have GL. So half GL is your speed meters per second. Any questions? Yeah. Anything you want to ask? Anything you want to ask? Is this clear? Okay, so shall we move on to another one? So we need to, you know, you need to practice a lot with this chapter. You know, I know it doesn't come to you on a single day. It will not dawn on you. Don't expect that to happen. It will not. So you need to work hard on this subject, definitely, right? So shall we start question number 3? Can you all give an attempt with question number 3? Okay, so question number 3, a light elastic spring of natural length 2L, a light elastic spring, so bear in mind they use the word spring here, a light elastic spring of natural length 2L has its end attached to two points P and Q which are at the same horizontal level. Okay, so there are two points called P and there is another point called Q, so they are at the same horizontal level. Okay, P and Q are at the same horizontal level. Okay. So what are they saying? Okay, the natural length is 2L. It's attached to two points P and Q, which are at the same horizontal level. The length of PQ is 2L. Okay, so that's good. So then it's at the spring is at its natural length. Are you okay with that? So if this length is also 2L, then this spring is already in its natural length. Have we stretched it? Have we compressed it? No, right? the spring is also having a natural length 2L. PQ is so PQ is where you are having your spring. So you are having your spring here, right? This is the spring. So the spring is at its natural length. So no problem, right? No problem so far. You haven't stretched it. You haven't compressed it. Okay, no issues. Right. Now what's happening? Okay, the length of PQ is 2L, right? A particle of mass m is fastened to the midpoint of the spring. So what are they doing here? They are saying they are taking a particle and they are attaching it to the midpoint of the spring. So now we've done a question like this earlier. Do you remember what's the theory I told you? When you attach a particle to the midpoint of your spring, what is the theory? What is the theory? When you attach a particle to the
two strings are the springs are there.
The single spring, you need to make it
becomes
two strings. It needs to become to two strings. Then the natural length of each spring becomes how much? So then it's 2L.
L.
It becomes L each. So I'm going to erase it. I'm going to attach a particle to the middle. And now instead of working with one spring, I'll be working with two. So I'm going to attach a particle M in the middle. Okay, so I attach a particle M in the middle. So this becomes immediately, we separate into two springs. So now I have two springs. So now I have two springs. And then I was asking you this question earlier also. So though our spring divides into two, what about our lambda, modulus of elasticity? Will we divide that also by two? Now have they given us a lambda value? Have they given us a lambda? No, they have not given us lambda, but I think I told you in the earlier question also, right? We did one like this earlier. Will our lambda divide into two? Do we divide our lambda value by two? Lambda is the modulus of velocity, the proportion of how much it stretches with respect to the tension. So the more tension, so even though you your string divides into two or maybe three, or it doesn't matter how much you divide into, your lambda will not subdivide. Okay, so your lambda modulus of elasticity will remain the same because it's a constant throughout the entire spring. So though you may divide your spring into two, the lambda value for each part of the spring will be the same. Okay, so lambda will remain constant, but lambda is not given in this sum. Okay, now what happens? A particle of mass m is fastened to the midpoint of the spring and is held at the midpoint of PQ. The particle is released. So you are releasing this for this. So when you release this particle, what happens? Now you know this particle has a weight. This is at a horizontal, it's not at a table. No? You don't have any table or any supports here. P and Q are the two supports. P and Q are fixed. P and Q are fixed. And then when you put your particle of mass M over here, what is obviously going to happen? What is obviously going to happen?
It will go down.
It will go down.
Downwards.
It will go downwards, definitely. It will go down, or this will go down, right? It will start moving down, okay? And then they are saying, so obviously it will start moving down. It will start moving down. It's starting from rest, right? Because they are releasing it from rest. So starting speed is zero, releasing from rest, okay? And it first comes to instantaneous rest when both parts of the spring make an angle of 60 degrees with the line PQ. So it comes to instantaneous rest. What do you mean by instantaneous rest? Now, you know, when you release this, this will go down and it won't go down forever. It will come to a certain point where it stops and again, it will bounce back up, right? Do you understand? Can you picture this in your head? You release this, it comes down and then again, it will bounce back up, right? You understand, it comes down, bounces up. And maybe again, come down, it's kind of bouncing up and down. It's bouncing up and down. So they are saying it comes to instantaneous rest. It means instant rest. It comes to instant rest. So let's say this is at this point. Instant rest is at this point. So it comes to instant rest. Okay, so I will... So this is my spring. Can you see? So they say that it comes to instantaneous rest when both parts of the spring make an angle of 60 degrees. So they, it makes an angle of 60 degree with the horizontal, with the line PQ. Is that okay? Is the diagram clear now? Is the diagram clear now? Okay. So then, so what are they asking from you? Yeah, I think the question is on the other page, right? Find the modulus of elasticity of the spring. Okay, so 6 marks. I think you can see it's a lot of marks for this, right? 6 marks to find the lambda value. 6 marks to find the lambda value. Okay, let's get it done. So how do you find the lambda value here? So now, Shira, what is the rule we use here? Your target is to find lambda, and then you have all the information you need. So this particle starts falling from here, comes, falls down over here. And they say it's an instantaneous rest, means at this point also, what's the velocity? At this point too, your velocity will be? At this point too, your velocity will be, talk with me. They said, now you're dropping this particle, right? Methaninan drop down, this is falling down, accelerating, and then it again decelerates, comes to instant rest, and it kind of bounces back up, again comes down, something like that. That's what's gonna happen. My question is this, at this point, what's the velocity? I mean, do we have a velocity? They say it's at instantaneous rest, which means again, the velocity at this point will be zero. Okay, so then what's the principle we use here? So we are going to use the principle of energy. So first question, is it a system where energy is conserved, or do we have a system where we lose some of our energy? Falling from here to here. So I'll say this is point A. And I'll say this is point B. From A to B, do we have a system where energy is conserved, or do we have a system where we lose some of our energy? Talk with me. Do we have any resistive force? Do we have any resistive force? No, right? No. So therefore, energy is conserved. So energy at A and energy at B are the same. But now, you can see we are falling through a vertical height. So when you are falling through a vertical height, in this situation, we need to deal with what? Earlier question, we didn't have to deal with GPE, right? Gravitational potential energy. But in this question, you have some kind of a height involved. Therefore, you will deal with GPE. When you are dealing with GPE, what do you need to do for them? You need to mark a GPE zero level. You need to mark a GPE zero level. So from that GPE zero level, if you are above that GPE zero level, you have a positive GPE. If you are below the GPE zero level, then you have a negative GPE. So as a habit, I normally mark the lowest possible level in my sum as a GPE zero level, so that throughout my entire sum, my GPEs are positive. So if you all want, you can mark GPE zero level at the top. If you mark GPE zero level at the top, then when you go below the GPE zero level, this will be a negative GPE. But I, as a habit, I will mark my GPE zero level here. Mark it on your diagram, GPE zero level. You need to show it up to your examiner, okay? Otherwise, they would not know where the GPE zero level is. So you mark the GPE zero level to make it clear in your diagram. And then if you're at your GPE zero level, obviously the height is zero. There's no MGH, there's no GPE. If you're above the GPE zero level, you have a positive height, you have a positive GPE. If you're below your GPE zero level, you have a negative displacement. That means it's a negative GPE. Right. So let's talk about the conserved energy system here. So your energy at A is equal to your energy at B. The energy at A is equal to the energy at B. Okay, let's talk about the energy at A. What are the energies we have at A? So you have three options. Ke, kinetic energy, potential energy, and elastic potential energy. So what do we have at this point? Now you have two springs. Each of them have a natural length of L. Each spring has natural length L. First question, at A, do we have elastic potential energy?
No.
Is the spring stretched? No, it's at its natural length. So if it's at its natural length, so there is no extension. Then if there's no extension, there is obviously there's no elastic potential energy here, right? There's no EPE. What about kinetic energy? At this point? No.
At rest.
U is from rest. So U is zero. So no KE. Then what about GPE? Do we have GPE?
GPE is there.
We have GPE because you're above your GPE zero level. So you have GPE at A, exactly. So GPE at A. So GPE at A you have. What about, so let's go to B. So now think about your three energies. KE, EPE,
KE is not KPE. There.
So KE is not there, velocity is zero. What about gravitational potential energy? Do we have GPE?
Zero.
GPE is zero, zero level again. If your GPE is zero level, there's no height, there's no GPE. So there you don't have GPE at P. So there's no KE, there's no GPE. What do you have then? You have elastic potential energy, because you can see when you're moving down, definitely your spring is getting stretched, right? For this, when you're moving down, definitely the spring is getting stretched. So you have definitely EPE.
Yes.
Right, let's put the gain and loss. What happens to your GPE? So when you're going down, you're moving downwards, you're going your GPE is
losing, decreases.
So your GPE, you're losing it. It's a loss. GPE loss. So what about EPE?
EPE gain. It increases.
And it's stretching, right? So when you're stretching, your EPE is gain. So you can say GPE loss is equal to EPE gain. Okay, so this is the like the nine. I mean, like if you write like this, this looks so much better. EPE loss, GPE loss equals to EPE gain. So now time to put your GPE, EPE. I think you can see we run into a problem here. What's the problem? To put the GPE, we need the height. To put the elastic potential energy, so I'll put here, here this is mgh. This is lambda x square.
Did you find the lambda even?
So you can see we are trying to find lambda. Lambda is what we are trying to find. So what are things at this point that are unknown to us? So there are a few unknowns.
H.
H is unknown. The height is unknown. The extension is unknown. Natural length is unknown. So there are so many things that are unknown at this point. Right. So we need to fix that. How do we fix that? Right. We need to find the vertical height. Tell me a way to get this vertical height.
You can use Pythagoras theorem.
Pythagoras will not work, right? Because you don't know this. You don't know this.
Can find the P to the B length, right?
Can find the P to B length. How?
Because it's a equilateral triangle, same length, right?
So that concept is also there. That concept is also there. I think you can say 66.
2L.
This will be 60. So end of the day, it's equilateral triangle. So definitely this length, the other whole length is 2L. This will also be 2L. This will also be 2L. Yeah. That's one X way of doing. That's one way of doing, or you can simply use a grade 8-9 math where you use sine cos 10 for the right angle triangle here. It's a right angle.
Okay.
You can even use sine cos 10 and get the PB and the AB length. Or as you said, because these two guys are 60, the angles of a triangle, this should be 60. You end up creating an equilateral triangle. So this PQ length is 2L. Therefore, the other two lengths will also definitely be 2L. That's also one way of doing it. And then to find height, we can use tan?
Yeah.
Tan 60 to opposite. Opposite over adjacent. Adjacent is the PA length, right? So tan 60. AB length is H. PA length is L. Tan 60 is root 3L. And L comes here. So H equal root 3L.
Yeah.
H equals to root 3L. So then we found H, and then now let's talk about the
exo. Exo we can find.
M is how much? Mass is M, eh? Particle of mass M. Mass is M. M.
Yeah.
G, height is root 3L.
Mg. Root.
3L. Okay, now coming back to our spring, Buddha. Now, I told you, now we have two springs here, right? So when you're putting your energy, I'm going to consider the entire thing as one spring and put the energy, okay? If you want, you can put it separately, but I would prefer to put it at once. So if I take the entire spring, what's the total length? This side 2L, how much is the total
4L.
Length? 4L. So total length is 4L, and then the full spring, the natural length is 2L, right? The natural length of the full thing is 2L. Do you remember? Natural length of the full thing is 2L. Now you have a length of 4L. So how much is the extension? The natural length of the full thing was 2L. Okay, the natural length of the full thing was 2L.
2L, right? Then the extension, because 4 minus 2.
So then now the total length you have now is 2L on both sides. You have 4L. Do you see? that you have foil, this side foil, this side foil, so you have a full foil. So how much is your x then? So your x will be 4l minus 2l, your x will be
2l.
2l. So lambda, your extension will be 2l, and that should be squared.
Divided by 2l.
2l. So 2 times natural length is? What's the natural length of the entire thing?
2l.
Natural length is 2l. Do you see? Extension is also 2l. Natural length is also 2l. Do you understand this? This is, it's crucial you get it. Natural length
then
is
2l. Then you can cut one factor, right? 2l.
Yeah, you can cut off one factor of 2l and get lambda. So mg root 3l lambda into
lambda
2l square
2.
Over 4.
Yeah, okay.
So cutting off the 4, cutting off l, and we get lambda equals.
L and l also cancel.
Yes.
Mg root 3.
So you get root 3 mg. That is nice, right? And lambda equals root 3 mg. So that's your lambda value. Is that okay?
Yes. I took as 2 springs. I didn't take as 1.
Okay. Oh yeah, so then if you take it as 2 springs, you write the APE of each guy separately, right? Plus, plus.
Yeah.
Okay, that also can be. You can write the energy of each spring individually plus the other one. Can do that. And you should end up getting the same answer.
Yes.
And then what do they want for RB? Suggest, okay, which model could be refined to make it more realistic. So, so how can we make the model more refined to make it more realistic? Yeah, so they are saying here to find the, so how can we make it more refined? That means refining means to making it better, right? Refining a model is making your model better, like making it more realistic. So what they say here is actually what, to make it more refined, that you can, without ignoring the masses of the springs, to actually consider the mass of your the spring. So then that you can make it more refined in that way. Okay, so let's move on to the next one, right? I hope everything is clear. Is this okay? Any doubts, any issues? Okay, so I think I will do a few more. Let's try. I think we are basically done with the lesson. We just need to do a few sums. So basically we are done with the lesson. All we need to do is to do a few sums to make sure that you get the concept properly into your head. Okay, so there are a lot of sums in here. Shall we try? Let's try question number, maybe 4. Question number 5. And maybe we'll do question number 8. So let's do question number 5 first. Do question number 5 first. So look, in question number 5, a particle P is attached to one end of a light elastic string. So again, pay attention to the word string and spring. So they use the word string here of natural length A. Okay. The other end of the string is attached to a fixed point O when P hangs at rest in equilibrium. So this is not a system where you have horizontal table. This is a system where you have vertical, because they say here very clearly the particle is hanging at rest. Okay. So then I need to draw a series of diagrams where we hang the thing. Right, so let's draw a series of diagrams where we hang. So first thing, I mark this ceiling, and then I mark the natural length. So that's my first thing. Always my first thing is I mark the natural length. Okay, so I draw a series of diagrams. So this is my natural length L, right? Natural length is L. No, sorry, natural length is A. Natural length is A. Is that okay? And then what are they doing? So they say they are hanging a particle of mass. They have not told. So we say the mass is M. They are hanging a particle of mass M. So obviously when you hang a particle of mass M, what happens? Obviously when you hang a particle of mass M, it will stretch, right? This will slightly stretch. Okay. This will slightly stretch. So let's say the extension is unknown, X. Natural length is A. Natural length is A. The distance, so they are saying, so okay, so then you have that. right? The P hangs at rest in equilibrium. So this is the equilibrium position. Okay, so this is in equilibrium, right? This is the point where it's in equilibrium, right? So then when P hangs at rest in equilibrium, the distance OP, when P hangs at rest in equilibrium, the distance OP is 5A over 3. Right, so they say when you hang at rest in equilibrium, the distance OP, so I think O is over here, particle P is over here, so OP is 5A over 3. What do they expect you to find from that piece of information? When you say OP is 5A over 3, what can I find from that information, Buddha? That means this
extension can be found.
How much is the extension? This entire length is 5A over 3. The entire length is 5A over 3. So how much is the x then?
2 over 3, right? 2 over 3.
2A over 3. So I'll remove the x from here and mark it as 2A over 3.
5A.
Okay, so I'll mark it as 2A over 3, right? So, from that, what do they find? Why do they give that? What can I find from that? There is something that is not given in this sum. So we, by using that piece of information, children, we can get the value of our lambda. We can get the value of our lambda. Mark the forces here. So I'll say the mass is mg. Mass is mg. This is not the sum, by the way. In the sum, they are saying they are taking this particle to from O and they are releasing it. So that is something else. I still did not go there. I still did not come to this point where they are releasing it with speed u. I did not come there. I'm just going to come to this point where it's hanging in equilibrium. This guy is in equilibrium over here. So then mg is equal to what? For the, what other force do we have over here? What other force do I have over here when it's hanging in equilibrium?
Tension.
Tension. So you can say the tension at the equilibrium position. So when it's at its equilibrium position, this is before the, before we do our experiment, okay? So we still did not start our experiment where we are going to release it with that speed u. We did not go there yet. We just let it be at this point and then only we are going to do our experiment. So we can say T equal mg. This is before we start our experiment. So tension is equal to what? Lambda x over L, right? So lambda is unknown. Extension is how much? So we know the extension, right? We know the extension is 2a over 3. Are you with me? Extension is 2a over 3. Over natural length is a equals mg. So I think I can cut off a here, a to a. Then lambda equals, the 3 goes on the side, 3mg over 2. Any questions? Lambda is 3mg over 2. So this is how it initially looks. Is this okay? Is this okay? Right. So then we found our lambda value. Now let's go back to our sum. Going back to the sum, read this. The particle is now projected vertically downwards from O. What are they saying? The particle is now projected vertically downwards from O with speed u. Can you tell me what exactly are they doing here? Now this was hanging in equilibrium. What are they doing now? The particle is now projected vertically downwards from where? From O. So you are throwing it down. That means you take your particle, you take it to O and you're throwing it down. Okay, you're throwing it down. So what happens here is basically, okay, so I'll draw another diagram. You lift your particle up. So then this string is becoming maybe loose over here. It's totally loose, right? So you take your particle at this point. Do you see? Your particle is there now at this point. Can you see? And you're not just putting it, you're throwing it. You're throwing it with a speed of u. Can you all understand? You lift the particle up, you take it beyond, you take it up, so the string will become slack, right? You agree the string becomes slack. You know, you take it up. So this is over here, the string, this part becomes slack. And then you take it up and you throw it down. So when you throw it down, what happens? So when you throw it down, what happens? This will obviously, you know, gravity also helps. It will go accelerating down. Do you think it will stop at the equilibrium point?
No, it goes 10a over 3.
It goes 10a, they say it goes 10a over 3, which means it will go double of this distance, right? 5a over 3, it goes double of that before it actually comes to instantaneous rest. You understand? When you throw it down, this will go, it's like a yo-yo. You know, where you throw it down and it again comes back up, again goes down, again comes back up, something like that. So, you throw it down.
Twice at the equilibrium, yeah.
So this goes down like this. Can you see? This started from over here. Let me make it a little bit shorter. This particle comes all the way over here where this distance will be 10a over 3. The distance will be 10a over 3. So that this value is 10a over 3. Okay, is that okay? Harda? So now you know the concept here. We are going to use energy. We are going to use energy to find, they're asking us to find capital U in terms of A and G. Okay, so I really want you all to pay attention to this sum because these are the types of sums you get in your exam. You can see these types of sums. We don't have to use the cal, right? You can see your calculator is not going to be used much. So that's what's going to happen in M3. Though you have your calculator will not be used a lot. So please get used to deal with, get used to working with these letters. Get used to working with these letters, right? So what happens here? So we use energy conservation here. So at what point to what point do you want to use energy? Do you, can you give me an idea? From where to where will I use energy? This point is O. So let's say this point is natural length is A, equilibrium is B, finishing point is C. Where, from where to where is it, should I consider energy? Where and where energy should I compare to get an answer, to get U in terms of G? Where, at which two positions do I know everything? Because you can do energy from O to A if you want, A to B if you want, any point, any two points you can choose. But the two points you choose, at those two points, you need to know absolutely everything at those two points. So tell me, from where to where, children? From where to where will you put it? Yeah, you can send your answers on the chat. Okay, UN says O to C. O to C. So what about the others? Any ideas? Where to where should I compare my energies? Between O to B. So Ryan, if you compare from O to B, what is the issue at O to B? You can compare, okay, what are the energies at O? So I think everyone agrees we have to start at O. Okay, so energy at O, what is the energy you have at O? You are releasing from what? You are releasing with speed U. You are releasing with speed U, so definitely what do you have? Talk with me. Definitely what do you have? When you are throwing with speed U, you have KE, kinetic energy. And then I think you can see we are moving through some vertical height. You will definitely have GPE, okay? Depending on your GPE zero level. And then what about elastic potential energy? Do we have any elastic potential energy at O? Do we have any elastic potential energy at O?
No, right? Because no. The line is up.
No, why? Because it's a string, not a spring. Remember, we are talking about a string here, not a spring. Now, a spring you can compress. But a string, can you compress the rubber band? Can you compress the elastic string? Definitely not. So if you take it behind its natural length, it will just be like a normal string, flat. So if it's flat, obviously there is no elastic potential energy. Elastic potential energy only happens if you have an extension, if you have an X value. So there is no X value for this object at this point. So at O, you just have GPE and the KE. Okay, now what is the issue at B? Now, some of you said, let's compare O to B. At B, okay, we can, so you can find the GPE, you can find the elastic potential energy, that's fine. But there is a small problem at B, Buddha. What is that? At B, do we have KE or not? Do you think we just come to zero here at B? You know, you're throwing it down. This is passing all these places and coming down to get velocity zero at C, right? This is passing through all these points and coming over here, and velocity becomes zero, right? So at this point B, Huda, you have some unknown velocity. Do you get what I'm trying to say here? You have some velocity. It's not zero, right? At B, you don't come to rest here and then again go down. You don't slow down, come to B, slow down, and if you slow down, you are again bouncing back up. They say it's slowing down at this point C here. So at the point B, definitely it's passing down and going through B with some kind of a velocity, which we really don't know. So in that case, there you deal with an unknown velocity, and then you cannot find your U. Then you will be getting stuck with two unknown velocities because initial velocity is also unknown. So therefore, it should not be from O to B. It should be from O to C. So it should be from O to C. So then C is my lowest level. I will consider my GP zero level at C. So I will consider my GP zero level at C. So then I will consider energy at O equals to energy at C. Energy at O equals to energy at C. Okay, now talk to me. Energy at O, you were telling me we have gravitational potential energy plus elastic potential energy. This is different from the earlier systems, right? Earlier system, we just had one. But now at O, you have GPE and not elastic potential energy because it's zero. Sorry, you have KE, kinetic energy. You have kinetic energy, agree? Okay, what about energy at C? So give me your comments about energy at C. So give me your comments about energy at C.
GP is zero, kinetic is zero, and only elastic potential.
GP is zero, yes, GP is zero level. Kinetic energy is zero because your velocity is zero. Then the only energy you have is the elastic potential energy. The only thing you have is the EPE. Let's talk about the gain and loss. Let's talk about the gain and loss. GPE, you're coming down. Are you gaining or losing? GPE, are you gaining or losing? Talk with me.
Losing.
GPE loss plus KE. What about KE? At the end of the day, you can see we are, what happens? Starting with U and you're ending with zero. Your KE is gained or lost? It's lost, right? KE is lost because you start from U, you end up with zero. KE loss equals to elastic potential energy is a? Elastic potential energy?
That's gaining.
That's a gain. So let's put everything. GPE is mgh. KE is half mv square. Elastic potential energy is lambda x square over 2l, right? So put everything. You found the lambda value. Lambda value was found earlier. Height is known. I think you just need to find your extension. And what? You have to just make you the subject. Find u in terms of a and g. 7 marks. So definitely this is a kind of a question that you can expect to see in your M3 paper. This is a type of question that you can expect to see in your M3 paper. So what happens? MGH, height is how much? M.
It's 10
a over 3 plus half m is same m velocity starting
u
velocity
squared.
Lambda, yeah. We found 3mg over 2 x square. What is the extension, Anna? That is an important question. At this point C, what is the extension of your string? Give me comments on the chat. I want to see whether you can get it. Give me comments on the chat, not out loud. Tell me what is the x value of your string when it comes to point C. Give me your answers on the chat quickly, real fast. Yes, so Ryan is in the zone. He's totally in this. Yes, what about the others? What about the others? I have one answer on the chat. Quickly send me the answer of x. What is the extension when you are at the point C? What is the extension in your string? Yeah, two answers. Yes, three. So three people have sent me the extensions. What about the other? Extension is what, Padala? Extension is the length that you are stretching beyond your natural length. So it's the length that you stretch beyond your natural length. So your natural length is A. your natural length is a. So then you can see the extension is everything you have over here. This entire thing is the extension, because this is the length you have. Anything below a, basically anything below a, because at this point a, capital A, you have your natural length, and anything below capital A is counting for extension. Got it? So then this entire length x, which is how much? So to get this x value, you have to subtract 10a over 3 minus a. 10a over 3 minus a will give you 7a over 3. Is that okay? 10a over 3 minus a gives you 7a over 3. And that is your extension which you put for the x over here. So let's put that for the x. 7a over 3, and that also should be squared. Okay, divide by whole thing. Shall I write divide like this? Divide by 2l. Divide by 2l. 2 times natural length is a. Is this okay? I wrote the division mark with the division sign, so writing it down. Okay, I think it might help you also. So I hope everything is clear. All you need to do now is what? Make you the subject. So let's work on this now. So I'll write here 10mgA over 3. I'll need some space. I'll come over here. 10mgA over 3 plus half mu square equals 3mg over 2 multiplied by 49a square over 9. You agree, right? 7a square over 3 becomes 49a square over 9. Division becomes multiplication. And this becomes 1 over 2a. Division to multiplication, 1 over 2a. And now there are 3 blocks here. You can see there are 3 blocks. 1, 2, and this is 3. So anything, if there's any letter or number who is common to everyone, you can remove. So for example, M is common to everyone. So there are 3 blocks. All 3 blocks have the letter M. So that can be removed. What else can I remove? That's all, right? Okay, that's also awesome. Then let's simplify. 10gA over 3 plus half u square equal, this becomes, I can cancel off, right? Can you simplify this guy? 1a to 1a I can cancel off. Can you tell me how much is 3 over 2 into 49 over 9 into 1 over 2? How much is the answer? 3 over 2 into 49 over 9 into 1 over 2. Can I know the answer? 49 over 12. Agreed? 49 GA over 12. And then take everything to one side. So I'll take the 10 GA over 3 to the other side. So that gives me here the half U square remains. 49 GA over 12 minus 10 GA over 3. So 49 over 12, so it's the like terms, you can subtract. 49 over 12 minus 10 over 3, how much is it? 49 over 12 minus 10 over 3, how much is it? 12 times 3 times 4, right? And then so 49 minus 49 GA over 12, is that correct? 9 and 12 can simplify. 3 times 3, so 3 over 4 GA. Is that correct? 3 over 4 GA, when you subtract 49 over 12 minus 10 over 3. Is it 3 over 4 GA? Can you all confirm?
Yes.
So it becomes 3 over 4 GA. And then you can take the 2 to the other side, goes as a multiplication. That would cancel out with the 4. So then you get 3 over 2 GA. So U is 3 over, U square is 3 over 2 GA. So U is root 3 over 2 GA. So they asked you what? The question was, find capital U in terms of A and G. So that's it here. Fine. We have found our capital U in terms of A and in terms of G. So we have done it, right? Can you see? I hope it's clear, because I'm taking time to do this chapter. I mean, to do some important questions rather than going to the next chapter rushing, because I think otherwise you may not understand. you are having any doubts, any issues, you can talk. So those who are done can now start question number 8. So in question number 8, I would prefer to see the diagram. The most important, the most valuable asset in this in M3 is your diagram. A clear diagram is going to be the key to your answer. So draw me a clear diagram. You can see the quality of the diagrams I'm drawing, so it needs to be very clear. Okay, so start drawing your diagrams for question number 8. So question number 8, a particle P of mass 2 kg is attached to one end of a light elastic string of natural length 1 meter and modulus of velocity 40 Newton. The other end of the string is fixed to a pointer on a rough plane which is inclined at an angle alpha, where tan alpha is 3 over 4. So they tell you, they're telling you what's happening over here. What's happening? You have an angle, you have over here an inclined plane, not a normal plane. You have an inclined plane. So you can draw an inclined plane any way you like. So I prefer to draw it this way. I don't know any direction you prefer, you can draw. Okay, so there is an inclined plane. Okay, so particle P of mass 2 kg is attached to end of a light elastic string of natural length 1 meter, modulus of velocity lambda 40. Let me mark that in a corner. Lambda is 40 Newton. Natural length is 1 meter, mass is 2 kilograms, okay. The other end of the string is fixed to a point on a rough plane which is inclined at an angle alpha, where tan alpha is 3 over 4. Now obviously, if you have a particle resting on this plane, you need to kind of realize that you need to realize that this particle is going to be below, right? So your fixed point is going to be above and the particle is kind of like going downwards on that plane, because you can't have it the other way. Right, so you can have your point or fixed point should be above, particle should definitely be below it, right? By common sense, so the fixed point is O, and then you have your particle. So here you have your particle. So this will obviously, when you have it with the weight of the particle, do you think when it's resting on the inclined plane, it will be at rest? It will be at rest. I'm saying, will it be in its natural length with the particle attached? With the particle's weight, do you think this length will be 1 meter? Natural length? Definitely not, right? It will move a little bit beyond its natural length because of the weight of the particle. So the fixed point is O, and then the natural length is 1 meter. Right, so you have definitely some extension here. You should definitely have some extension. And then they say tan alpha is 3 over 4. So the moment they tell you tan alpha is 3 over 4, what do? Immediately when they tell you tan alpha 3 over 4, you know you don't do tan inverse and get alpha. That's not how we do, even in M1, even in M2. So you draw the triangle and find the value of your sine alpha and cos alpha. So you end up getting here tan alpha to opposite over adjacent. 3 over 4, so you can get the hypotenuse by using Pythagoras theorem. 3 square plus 4 square square root should give me 5 over here, right? So then from this I can calculate my sine alpha. So sine alpha opposite over hypotenuse 3 over 5, cos alpha adjacent over hypotenuse 4 over 5. So this is all I need to do my sum. So sine alpha and cos alpha is done. Okay, sine alpha and cos alpha is done. Now it's time to mark it on the plane. Mark the other information. What else have they said? Tan alpha 3 over 4 done. The particle is held at O. And released. Okay, I did not see that part. So then that's not how it's done. So then you take your particle to O and you're releasing it from rest. Do you see what's happening? So at the initial stage, of the diagram, if I draw the inclined plane at the initial stage, so this is the point O. So you keep your particle at O, right? So So the string is slack at this point. It's a string here. They are using a string here. So the string will be slack. So you are there. Say the particle is held at O. So that means you are keeping it at O, like we did the earlier question. You take it to the very top and release from rest. So your starting speed is zero. So you are releasing it from rest, and then it will slide down, right? Obviously, the particle will slide down. And they say, do we have friction here? Coefficient of friction. Yeah, they say friction, right? The particle is held at O, released from rest. Given that P comes to rest after moving 2 meters down the plane. So this comes to rest after it moves 2 meters. So it comes to rest after moving 2 meters means how much is the extension? How much is the extension? Natural length is L. If it's moving a total of 2 meters, that means the extension also should be 1 meter. Are you okay with that? Are you okay with that? They say the particle comes to rest. So this you stop from, I mean you release from here with rest. This slides down. It keeps sliding down until, you know, it won't. It will come to a point where the string will stretch and make it kind of stop. So then you need to, it stops when it's at a, when it has moved 2 meters down the plane, which means you have an extension of 1 meter. Do you agree? Find the coefficient of friction between the particle and the plane. So they say there is friction over here as well. Okay, so you have friction over here too. They want to find the mu value, the coefficient of friction. Okay, so how do we find the coefficient of friction? There are actually two ways of doing this sum. Okay, so one way of doing this is by using the work energy principle. The other way of doing this is by doing equilibrium. There are two ways, either number one by work energy principle, number two is by using the forces, equilibrium forces. So which way shall we do? Shall we do both ways? Like, I mean, you can do any one.
We'll do equilibrium.
We'll do equilibrium. Okay, you need to do both ways, because if they ask you to do this sum by using a work energy principle, then you cannot use equilibrium. Okay, so you can do this sum by both ways, work energy principle, or by using forces. So first we'll do by forces. Okay, so if I do this with forces, is it possible to do with forces? They say velocity is zero here. Let's see whether it's possible. Otherwise, we'll have to go with work energy principle. So mass is, what do they want us to find by the way?
Coefficient of friction.
Find the coefficient of friction. Okay. Coefficient of friction.
We have to mark the forces.
Yeah. So mass is not given, right? Is it given?
Yeah, it's 2 kilograms, I think.
2 kilograms. Yeah. Mass is 2 kilograms. Mm,
2 g.
Yeah, then. Mass is 2 kilograms, yeah. So then mark it. Mass is 2 kilograms, so you have 2 g. Then what else do we have?
R.
Yeah, so we run into a problem here. So we can't do work energy principle, because it comes to rest after moving 2 meters down the plane because of friction. The problem comes with friction, because after it comes, like when it's at rest over here, okay, the friction, I'm not sure which way to mark the friction, because we don't know whether it's trying to go down or maybe going to go up again. So they've not mentioned that. You know what? They've not mentioned that. So the direction of friction, I prefer to go with the work energy principle. That's what we've been doing all this time. Let's go with the work energy principle. So starting at O, ending at A. Let's go with the work energy principle. So energy at O equals to the energy at A. Is that going to be the case now? Is that going to be the case? Now you can see we have a resistive force, right? We have friction now. So now, are we going to have a conserved energy system, or do we have a system where we lose part of our energy? Definitely. What's happening here? Initial energy, whatever you have at the very beginning, will you conserve and have it at the very end? The initial energy is what you have, the whole chunk, right? So that's the whole load. That entire chunk, do you have at the very end? When you have a resistive force, obviously no, right? Why? The initial and final will, so the final energy. So what happens is when you have some kind of a resistive force, part of your initial chunk of energy is going to go for work done by friction. So then initial and final and normal in a conserved system, they are equal. But in this system, the initial is larger, final is smaller, because final doesn't have everything as the initial. So part of the energy, now to balance this equation, so final doesn't have everything that was over here. So part of this initial, part of it is going to the final, and another part, it goes for work done by friction. So this is something you learn in M2. This is a formula you learn in M2. In M2 they give in the book as work done by friction is equal to initial energy minus final energy. Okay, so initial energy, the whole chunk of energy is not there at the end. So final energy plus another part of it goes for work done by friction. Right, so let's talk about the initial energy. So I can see we are moving, though we are not directly moving vertically, we are moving in a vertical manner. I mean, like we have some kind of a vertical displacement. So you will have to mark GP zero level. So I'll mark the lowest level here, this level, as my GP zero level. So mark your GP zero level in the sum. And then when you mark, so definitely mark the GP zero level. Okay, let's talk about the energy at O. Initial energy means at O. What are the energies we have at O? Talk about it over here. You are releasing it from rest. The string is slack. You are releasing it at the very top. So what are the energies you have? Do you have KE? Energy, the releasing from rest, the velocity is zero. So no KE. The string is slack. There's no extension. So no EPE. The only thing you have is GPE because you're above your GPE zero level. So you are above your GPE zero level, and that vertical height should be found, that H. So you can see I marked the H here. H is always a vertical height. You cannot mark a slant height for H. H has to be a vertical height above your GPE zero level, right? So initial energy is GPE. That's correct, Brian. So initial energy GPE, no KE, no EPE, right? Let's talk about the final energy at this point. At this point, you're at your GP zero level. Your kinetic energy is zero. Your velocity is zero, right? So what do you say about the type of energy you have at point A? Answer me. What is the type of energy you have at point A? Do you have
elastic energy? Potential energy.
Elastic potential energy, right? No, not KE, Ryan. Because at this point at A, they say it comes to rest. It's at rest. It comes to rest 2 meters below the plane, 2 meters below O. So you won't have KE. You have elastic potential energy. So then you have EPE. That's all. You don't have KE. You don't have GPE, right? GP zero level means no GPE. Plus you have the work done by friction. Normally, how do you calculate the work done by a force? Work done by a force is calculated by the force into its distance, right? Do you remember the M2 formula? Work done by a force is found by multiplying the force with the distance. Okay, agreed? Force multiplied by distance. Okay, so then the force here is the friction force multiplied by distance. So let's get it done. So here the force is the friction. So GPE is MGH. Elastic potential energy is lambda x square over 2L. Force is the friction force. It's the friction force multiplied by the distance, right? Let's mark everything. Let's mark everything. Can you all tell me mass is how much? The mass of the thing is 2 kilograms, right? Mass is 2 kilograms. Mass is 2 kilograms. Into G, into how much is the height? Can you all tell me how to find the height? How much is this height, the vertical height? I need to find it in terms of, I need to find it properly. How do I find it?
We can resolve the length,
we can,
right?
Resolve this 2 meter, right? And you know this is alpha, so corresponding angle, you can mark the alpha over here also, right? This alpha can be marked over here and you can resolve this 2. So 2 cos alpha this way. Height will be 2 sine alpha. You can use sine cos tan. I just directly resolve the hypotenuse. The 2 meter is the hypotenuse of this triangle. So 2 away from the angle, 2 sine alpha. Is that okay? Or you can say sine alpha opposite over hypotenuse. So opposite is H, hypotenuse is 2. So then H becomes 2 sine alpha. Is that okay? So height is 2 sine alpha. Equals lambda is 40. Extension is how much at the point A? The natural length is 1, the whole length is 2, so an extension is 1, right? 1 square over 2 times natural length is 1. Plus friction. Friction we don't know, friction force we don't know. Distance, what's the distance traveled under the friction force? What is the distance that this particle travels under the friction force? Do we have a vertical height? Are we going to use the 2 sine alpha? Is that why are we going to use this horizontal distance, or are we going to use this 2 meters? So then the distance in here, frozen distance, means the distance that the object travels with this force. So the force means the friction force. So what is the distance your particle traveled under the friction force? How much of a distance did your particle travel?
2 meters.
2 meters. You have to take the 2 meters because the particle traveled on the surface of this. So it traveled the 2 meters under the friction force. So 2 meters. So now your task is what? Get the friction force subjected. Get me the value of F. Sine alpha is found. 2g is
3.52 newton.
You know g is 9.8. Huh? Yeah. 2 into sine alpha 3 over 5. Here 40 into 1 square is 1 over 2. Plus 2F. So take everything to one side, subtract. Yeah, how much did you say about that? 2 into 9.8. Multiply by 2, multiply by 3 over 5. Subtract the 40 over 2. And then the whole thing you divide by 2 to get F, right?
3.52 newtons.
Exact?
Yeah.
3.52 newton is your friction force. And that is your friction force. Is that okay? That's the friction force that you're experiencing here. So then the friction force is, children, the friction force is...
It is 1.76.
Sorry?
1.76.
Sounds like wrong.
Yeah, I didn't know about it.
Can someone kind of, you know, second this answer? Is this okay? Is 1.76 okay? Can you kind of confirm it to me? Yes, it's correct. Okay. So then 1.76, then what you do is, Badala, they are asking you to get the coefficient of friction. So, you know, you're moving now, the system with this friction, it was moving along here, right? So then when you're moving, when your system is, when the object is moving, you know, what friction do we have? Do we have like the normal less than equilibrium? I mean, like, you know, friction has a maximum friction, right? And then you have a friction lower than that when you're in equilibrium. So then the system was moving, the object was moving, right? At this point. From O to A. So when you're moving, you have the maximum friction, mu r. So you can say your friction equals to mu r. So your the maximum friction is mu r. So this object was moving with the mu r friction. Okay. Okay. So then F max is, so then the friction is found with the friction is 1.76. Mu is unknown. What about the normal reaction? Can you tell me how to find normal reaction from this guy? M1. Getting normal reaction is M1.
It's mg cos.
Yeah.
Alpha.
They've told you, right? The mass is actually, M is given by that. M
two,
is
2. 2g so cos 2G. Alpha.
Normal reaction is always marked perpendicular to the plane. So this is M1. You mark the normal reaction perpendicular to the plane. And then to get the normal reaction, you need to resolve, right? You need to resolve your 2G. So then, you know, when you're resolving it. So when you're resolving it, the alpha comes over here, right? So M1, and this becomes 2G cos alpha. And you get another component to the other side, 2G sin alpha. We don't need it because we didn't go to solve it by comparing forces up equilibrium. We did not compare that, we went with energy. So at this point, we need R equal 2G cos alpha. So R is 2G cos alpha, and then you can replace your cos alpha. Cos alpha is found as 4 over 5. Can you subject mu and give me the answer? How much is mu? How much is mu?
We got 11 over 98.
11 over 98. Can someone confirm that answer? 11 over 98. Can someone confirm the 11 over 98? Can you second it whether it's correct or not? It's correct. Okay. 11 over 98. Right. So then that's it, children. So this is the lesson. Chapter 2. M3. It's done. It's over. Okay, so at this point, you need to now you are capable of doing another question in your past paper, right? Because definitely you will get one question from this work energy principle. So with this work energy principle, you will definitely get one question in your paper, in your exam, in the M3 paper. So I suggest you get started with that immediately. Okay, so maybe completing the past paper is going to be really important. So just start doing that. So next day we can start chapter 3. And remember to go to chapter 3. You need to be really good with chapter 1 and chapter 2. Chapter 1, constant the changing acceleration, acceleration as a function of time and displacement. You need to know that. As well as this Hooke's law and the conservation of energy, the work energy principle, you should be quite good with that before we go to chapter 3 dynamics. So I really want you all to go through that. And to go through these two chapters, really thoroughly do these sums again so that you can, you can be properly prepared to do the chapter 3 on the next day. Okay, so then I hope everything is okay, right? So okay, so then I'll stop from here. Okay, so I'll stop from here.